that helps.
So, when did this place look like in 1940 when people were still here? Must have been pretty bad.
People were still here in 1940?
Production until 19, the war, until 1940, so it was still producing a little bit.
Well, and it's hard to say which homes they were living in. But
right, there was a school and a post office. Yeah. Having a
yep. Where are all these people?
I know.
Hello.
Started making their way to the eastern slopes in search of gold. So there were actually a few mining towns in the area before Bodie that sort of marked the place as having both gold and silver. Monoville and Darktown would have been to our south. Darktown would have been right about where you turned off 395 if you came up 270, and Monoville would have been down top of the canyon, which is the other road you might have come in on today. Then Aurora was to our northeast, about 7 miles distant, actually in Nevada. It was a town that rivaled Bodie in size, but unfortunately there's very little left there today because it was built almost entirely of brick, which was all salvaged after people left. So all these places sort of marked the area as having gold and silver. And in 1859, a man named W.S. Bodie, Poughkeepsie, New York, along with partner E.S. Black Taylor, had been scouring the area for a few years looking for gold and silver when they stumbled onto an area we now call Taylor's Gulch, just on the other side of the ridge. There they discovered a seasonal creek, which they began panning for gold. From that panning, they found a few gold flakes, enough to tell them there was gold there, but not enough to placer mine. So they began following the creek upwards, looking for signs of hard rock gold. They eventually found a large ledge of quartz. Quartz is a rock, a mineral, that four hard rock mines often use hand in hand with gold. So the two men took a chance, struck their claim at that quartz ledge, and started the Bodie mining ledge. Unfortunately, neither of the men would be around much longer to see much of the money come out of that discovery. About 3 months after their initial discovery of gold, they had built a shanty, started gathering some supplies, started preparing to mine, and they went down to Monoville, one of those other nearby mining towns I mentioned, on another supply road, and on their way back up Cottonwood Canyon, the early season blizzard hit. Bodie actually became hypothermic and exhausted, could not continue on his own. Taylor was a very small man. He was only about 4'9". He carried Bodie as far as he could, then decided to wrap him in a blanket, leave him in the snow, and go back to the shanty to retrieve a sled to come back and save him. Unfortunately, in the snowstorm, Taylor became lost, and it took him several hours to get back to the shanty. By the time he got there, the night had fallen and the blizzard had intensified, so he was not able to go back out to prepare for being lost and perishing himself. He instead went out the next morning to look for Bodie, but at that point, there was about 6 feet of snow on the ground. He searched for a full 2 days and found nothing. It wasn't until the following spring, when all the snow finally melted, that Bodie's remains were actually recovered. And by that point, the bones had been so well chewed over by coyotes and buzzards that they could only identify the body by a distinct Bowie knife that Bodie always wore on his belt. So interestingly enough, that was in keeping with minor superstitions at the time that claimed that anyone who discovered a rich vein of gold or silver would very quickly suffer a very tragic fate. That was in keeping for Taylor as well. Taylor died about a year after Bodie when he had an encounter with the local Mono Basin Paiute tribe. They actually ended up shooting him with bows and arrows and then decapitating him and displaying his head as a trophy for another use. So both the men who actually discovered gold and silver track, a baseball field, a bowling alley, a roller rink, an ice cream shop, sort of anything you could expect out of a larger, more centrally located city, you could find all the way up here in Bodie. Lots of people think of Bodie as sort of a podunk little mining town, but in a lot of ways, for its time period, it was a very large, very modernized city. It was, of course, because of our remote location, because of the nature of a mining town, a little more rough and tumble than your average city. So the big difference between Bodie and a city like San Francisco or New York was largely the climate. We're at about 8,500 feet here, meaning summers can be a little hot and a little dry. They're not too bad, but winters, on the other hand, are brutal. Our record low here in Bodie is negative 37 degrees Fahrenheit before wind chill. We often, during the winter, get 10 feet of snow with 15, 20 foot drifts. This previous winter, those barn doors there were completely covered in snow. Those who lived in one-story homes historically would often have to dig upward out of their doorways to get out. Those lucky enough to live in a two-story home would often jump out of a second-story window to get out during the winter. So winters were very tough on the individual Bodeites. Then we had various sorts of man-made conditions here in the basin, making life very difficult as well. So the first big issue with pollution we had was in our groundwater. Groundwater was contaminated with human waste from pit toilets, animal waste from milk and grain supplies, and worst of all, mercury and cyanide used in our stamp mills in the extraction process for gold. So those stamp mills caused a lot of pollution. For those of you who don't know what a stamp mill is, it's basically a factory that processes our hard rock gold and silver ore. So it has to first crush it up and then use those toxic chemicals to extract the gold and silver from the waste rock. So first, they were leaching mercury and cyanide in the ground. Then they also caused a lot of the stamps on the mechanisms actually go up and down and crush the rock. They're big iron rods that weigh about 1,000 pounds and go up and down 90 times per minute, 24 hours a day, 6 days a week. We only have one stamp mill left today. It is a 20 stamp mill. That is 20 of those 1,000-pound stamps. But it was one of 8 stamp mills here in the basin during the heyday, the largest being a 40 stamp mill. So it always would have been incredibly noisy here in the basin. They say you could hear Bodie about 3 miles an hour. So if you came in 270, about where you hit the dirt road coming off the pavement, is where you'd start to hear the town. They also say that on Sundays, the one day the mills were not in operation, the mothers could never get their babies to sleep because they missed that lullaby of the stamps. Then our stamp mills also caused a lot of air pollution because they were all originally steam-powered and used wood-burning boilers. Again, we have one stamp mill left. The 20 stamp mill burnt 20 quarts of wood a day. For those of you who might not know what a quart of wood is, it's 4 foot by 4 foot by 8 foot stack of wood. So a large truck bed full of wood, 20 loaves a day at that mill alone, plus 8 other mills up and down the basin, steam engine from the wheat sheaves and the mines, and of course, wood being burnt and coming from heat. When all was said and done, on a good day, the town of Bodie could burn 300 cords of wood, which meant that in a time the wind died down, there would be just choking amounts of wood smoke, so make it difficult to even breathe at times. Then we had the whole sort of bad man of Bodie aspect going on here. I don't know if you folks have heard of the bad man, but he's basically the stereotype of a Bodie miner. He's someone who, after work, likes to go down to one of our over 60 saloons, drink for hours on end, and then just generally cause a ruckus. Night fights, fist fights, and gun fights were not at all uncommon during Bodie's boomings, and murder a night was pretty much standard. A common saying among the shopkeepers at the time was, "Do we have a man for breakfast?" Meaning was someone shot during the night, left laying out in the street to be dragged off the next morning. So that mostly would have taken place on the north side of town. But we're on the south side of town. This would have definitely been the more respectable neighborhood. Both of our churches were on this side of town. On Main Street, the businesses were at general stores, hotels, the miners' union halls on Main Street. Here on the south side of town, it was definitely the more respectable neighborhood. It was very safe on this side of town. People on this side of town would often leave their doors unlocked. Children would play in the streets. Women could walk around unattended. It was, in a lot of ways, safer than a big city like San Francisco or New York. But as you got more and more towards the north, that became less and less true. So the north side of town, businesses would have been gambling houses, saloons, opium dens, and our extensive red light district, which had an entire street dedicated to Bonanza Street, which is nicknamed, ironically, Virgin Alley. So that side of town would have been much rougher. You definitely would have had to watch your back more on that side of town. And respectable citizens would have stuck very closely over here. So this picture I've sort of painted for you of our boom years did not last very long. It lasted maybe at most 5 years, about 1877 to about 1882, and that varies depending on who you ask. But during 1882, regardless, the town started to bust. And if you asked a miner during the bust, and a historian today, what caused the bust, you'd actually get two very different answers. So again, miners were very superstitious. We held another one of the was that a church and a hangout would kill any good miner. Surprisingly, in the town's history, there was only ever one hangout, which took place in late 1881. Both our Methodist and our Catholic churches were built in 1882, and incidentally, that was the year the town started to bust. Today, though, we have maybe a little more concrete reason for why the town started to die off, and that's actually that there was a stock market scare in San Francisco. All of our mines and our mills were publicly traded corporations. The stock market scare caused a lot of people under, and that's more likely why people started to leave. So after this, the town became much, much quieter. In just about 6 months, the town went from somewhere around 10,000 people down to just about 2,000. So it became a much quieter town. Then there were several more events that kind of hastened Bodie's demise. The first was a large fire in 1892 that took place on the north side of town. It started in a kitchen as a grease fire in one of the saloons. And it ended up burning down most of the north side of town. The only way to save this side of town was by tearing down the buildings on Main Street between the fire and us. And after that, many of the single miners moved out because the north side of town, as I mentioned, was the rougher neighborhood, the area those miners sort of thought of as their entertainment. Once that was gone, they thought this town wasn't too much fun anymore. and they started to leave, but many of the family miners stayed here. So during this fire, the population dropped from about 2,000 maybe to 1,500 or 1,000. Then the next date we're going to talk about is 1932. And in 1932, there's a little boy named Billy Godward living here in town. He is only 2.5 years old. It doesn't seem like there's anything particularly special about him, but he is about to become infamous in Bodie's history. So the story goes that one day there's to be a birthday party for a 4-year-old girl named Winifred in our schoolhouse. And little Billy is super excited because he's never had cake or ice cream before. And he heard that every birthday party has both cake and ice cream. But this was 1932, Great Depression times in America, which meant no one could afford cake or ice cream. Instead, Winifred's mother decided to serve lime jello at this birthday party. Do any of you folks prefer lime jello to cake and ice cream? We got one? Oh, three. Wow, that's the most I've ever had to say yes. All right. Well, Billy agreed with the majority of you. He was not real happy with the lime jello. He threw a tantrum so awful that as a 2.5-year-old child, he was asked to leave the party. He then went down to the sawdust corner saloon on Main Street, where he began playing with matches. He ended up catching that building on fire, and it was a very windy day, and as I mentioned, Main Street was wall-to-wall buildings. The fire spread from building to building to building through the brush, and that fire claimed about 75% of the town. That's the biggest reason we only have 10% of the town left today. Shut down mining here in Bodie as well as around the U.S. So if you're not mining up here in Bodie, there's really not much reason to be here, and this is when just about everyone left. But through this whole long, slow decline, there was always one family that was in constant here, even after World War II, and that was the Kane family. Those of you folks who have the guided tour have probably seen their name a time or two. We're actually sitting in front of one of their houses. And the Kane family were sort of the town's well-to-do. They started off in the lumber business, later became bankers, and came to own many of the most profitable mines and staples. So they always had a lot of money, and as people started to leave the town, the Kane family bought up every house, every business, every mine, and every bit of property that they could possibly could. And they did this for several reasons. First, because they were business people. They were getting this property fairly cheaply, and they believed the town was going to boom again someday, and they'd be able to sell it back at great profit. Second, because they're fairly kind and generous people. They knew that these miners had made them rich, and by buying up their property, they could sort of give them a nest egg to move on and start new lives. But most importantly to us, the Kane family bought up the town because they wanted to protect it. They'd seen the various other mining towns in the area just kind of disappear and fade away over the years because of looters, vandals, and thieves, and they wanted to make sure that did not happen to the building. So as everyone else was leaving, the Kane family stayed up here almost by themselves, eventually hired armed guards to stay up here with them and help protect the town. And then in 1962, the Kane family sold the town of Bodie to California State Parks for about $50,000 and started us down the road to what you folks see today. The one big issue we had when the Kane family sold us the town was that they were not yet ready to part with the ridge where all the gold and silver mining were actually located. Again, they believed the town was going to boom again. They thought they would strike the ridge off the mining claims. They thought the town itself. So this was a big worry for us at the time because the nature of hard rock mining causes a lot of vibration through dynamiting that quartz ore out of the ground and through crushing up to actually get to the gold and silver. Everything we have here in town is a one-wall structure, very old, very fragile. And as the company, and in the 1990s,